Welcome to another Rendezvous. We're back in the second semester with five brand new shows, and I think you'll like them. But for today, we're going to be looking at music, theater, exhibition, a little bit of the performing arts. Now, the first one we're going to be looking at is Jacques Higelin's upcoming shows on the 23rd, I think, 24th, 25th, and 29th, 30th of January, playing at the Spectrum. Now, we'll go behind the scenes of the Spectrum to have a look at the rehearsals. Now, French rock star Jacques Higelin is a very extravagant artist. He's a musician, a poet, and a very, very interesting person. Let's watch this clip. Okay, well, I enjoy that. You know, French rock star Jacques Higelin, the delays we had is taking effect on me. Higelin is really a great a rock legend, and his shows are really worth going to now. I think he's almost sold out for Friday and Saturday, so check the Spectrum because they do have additional shows going on the 30th, 29th of January. So check in over there. That's really worthwhile seeing. As well, now let's get on to the local side, and in our studio today we have with us two people over from the fine arts faculty, and they are Kathy O'Connell and Bill
Spanos.
Welcome to the studio.
Thank you.
Now you're here to tell us about the day of festivities going on the 30th of January, with regard to the fine arts faculty. I believe there's an exhibition.
Well, it's not exactly an exhibition. Mm-hmm. It's a general open house, and it's going to take place on both campuses at Loyola from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. and downtown on the Sir George campus from 2 till 7 p.m. Basically, performing arts will have different performances and allow people to go into classes. Performing arts would include music, theater, and dance. Mm-hmm. So people will be allowed to basically walk around, go into classes, watch the performances, or in progress classes, be it acting classes or dance classes.
Now, can anyone attend these festivities, or do you have to purchase any tickets, or is there a problem with having space to attend these functions?
Now, it was originally geared for students. We invited students from high schools, cégeps, mm-hmm. and junior colleges mm-hmm. from Ontario and Quebec, but it's open to the public. We've also had the posters put up in theaters and different art galleries, so it's open to anyone in Montreal.
Now, is this promoting the Faculty of Fine Arts? Is this to get more students coming in? Or if you've sent these brochures around to the cégeps, I guess you're interested in explaining what your department does. So is this something that you, where you display the talents of the students, or is this just more of an explanatory, informational type of thing?
It's, in a sense, it's to promote the faculty to prospective students, mm-hmm. But it's not just promotion in the sense of being able to get students, mm-hmm. New students into the faculty. It's to make the faculty known within the university, mm-hmm. and also let the public or the Montreal community mm-hmm. in general visit the faculty, and basically anyone who would be interested in any of the fine arts areas can visit the faculty on that day. Mm-hmm.
And if they become interested, we have application forms available. We have mm-hmm. promotional material. Mm-hmm. If they're interested in following up after the open house.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to add that downtown is, because there is a distinction, the performing arts will be taking place on the Loyola campus, and uh-huh. downtown
would that be throughout the day, or is it a certain time of the day? Are there different features or anything
performing arts
here that you'd like everyone to know about?
Yeah, performing arts mm-hmm. in the morning and the visual arts in the evening. Now, by visual arts...
At Loyola campus?
No.
Both campuses?
No.
No.
Performing
okay.
arts. Performing arts at Loyola from 9 to 1 o'clock.
Okay.
And visual arts downtown at the visual arts building on Dorchester between 2 and 7 p.m. So there's a clear distinction. Performing arts events are going to be going on in the morning at Loyola, and visual arts events or activities are okay. taking place in the afternoon
so
from 2 to 7.
To shunt back and forth and all. So for the performing arts, what would you recommend to really have a look at for the students that maybe might not have all that much time, would be, you know, hopping between classes?
Well, that depends on the interest of the student. The activities are going on yeah. at the same time. So if you're interested in music, you can simply go to the music area. If you're interested in dance, you can simply
visit the... So they have music and dance?
Yeah, music, right. dance, and theater.
Excellent.
So, and downtown, again, the activities are planned in such a way so that you can either choose activities or try and get to as many as possible mm-hmm. any time between 2 and 7.
Mm-hmm. Well, that sounds excellent. I know there's a lot of students out there who want to promote our own local students and promote Concordia at Fine Arts Faculty, too. So we'll be looking forward to that. Thanks for being with us today.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
And now coming up is a little segment from Woody Allen's new play playing at the McGill Players Theatre. So let's have a look at that.
I choose to kill the king.
Leave me alone.
stop. That's it, folks.
He's definitely dead. We better remove him.
We don't want to get involved.
The slave decides to be a hero.
What do you do?
Well, Jean-Marc, that's your name. You're director of God, the play from Woody Allen. Well, how did you choose the play first? What made you decide that play was going to be?
Well, it was a suggestion from the McGill Players on putting on this performance, but I had read it, and it's very much in the vein of theater that I like to put on, so that was my choice.
Well, Woody Allen has a reputation of being very crazy. Did you first think that this play was going to be challenging in some way?
Definitely. I think just the fact of having that amount of cast members is exciting, and all the differences in characters, trying to put everything together, I think is pretty remarkable.
Okay, I'm going to ask you a very pertinent question. What is the play about exactly? Because it sounds crazy. God, title, you know, God.
What is the play about? I think through discussions with the cast members, as well as everybody else, everybody has their own interpretation of the play. So the best thing is to come and see it and experience it yourself and decide what you want it to become.
Well, how did you all cope with your crazy characters in the first place? Anyway, I all encourage you to come and see their crazy play and come and see God.
Okay, well, that was Woody Allen's production of God, and I think it's crazy enough to bear his personal signature. So you can catch that at the McGill Student Union on McTavish Street. And I believe they'll be there from Wednesday to Sunday for the next 2 weeks. So check that out if you're in the mood for a funny kind of a play. Now let's go from a little bit crazy to a little bit serious. We have a beautiful French artist and very talented one, Paulette Tourangeau. And she has an exhibition of her works at the Maison de la Culture de Villeray. And we have a little segment there to show you exactly what she's done. So let's take a look at that.
The Maison de la Culture de Villeray is presenting an exhibition of 5 drawings by a talented Montreal artist, Paulette Tourangeau. It's an unusual exhibition because graphite, the substance found in lead pencils, was used to create the drawings. She says this is because she wanted to do the most she was capable of doing with the least means. Her pieces have religious and social themes to them, which she enjoys discussing.
I think that it's just something which comes to me naturally. I have a tendency to be attracted to social events and to social phenomena. Each drawing transmits something which can be related either to the society, to the Québécois society in its totality or partially. Most of the drawings have a social theme, but each has a different theme. For example, the first one, which is titled Primitivism in Urban society, treats with what I felt while I was living in a suburb of Quebec City. And the second one is called The Social Revolution in Quebec. The third one is called Does God Exist? And it reflects a phenomenon with which my generation has lived. And the fourth one is a tentative or an effort to invent a Québécois myth. And it is called The Rat of Appalache by Laurentier, while the fifth one is called The Creation of the Religious Myth.
Tourangeau studied philosophy at Ottawa University, an experience which has influenced her art. For example, the form of this drawing is based on the swastika, which she observed on early handmade blankets in Quebec, as a mystical and political symbol of the Nazis during World War II, and as a Hindu religious symbol representing the four elements of the universe. Seeing this figure as an archetypal symbol for a movement, here she links it to social change in Quebec.
The drawing was conceived in the years 1974-75, and I thought that the Quebec society was really moving fast. And there were three elements which were making the society move. It was the feminist movement, and it was the nationalist movement, and the socialist tendency in Quebec.
These are her first set of large drawings. They were completed in 1985, and she never expected they would be shown publicly. But she received a grant from the Minister of Cultural Affairs and is now in the middle of a Quebec tour of her works. Sylvain Galarneau, the agent responsable for the Maison, says the public's reaction to her work has been quite good.
Les gens au début sont, je dirais, généralement très surpris, un, par la dimension des œuvres et également par le médium utilisé. C'est pas tous les jours qu'on voit des toiles de 10 par 16 qui sont entièrement réalisées au crayon à mine.
Tourangeau is in the process of drawing her sixth work as her graphite exhibition moves on to Sherbrooke and Trois-Rivières. Her drawings will remain at the Maison on 6707 de la Rimier Street until February the 1st. It is open on the weekend so parents can bring the children. Children will probably not understand her work, but it isn't a bad thing for them to see an artist doing so much with something they use in school every day. This is Sunil Mitani for Rendez-vous.
Okay, well, that was interesting. And you know, some of the new movies in town that are around are really, really good. Now, I haven't had a chance to view them all, but there was one I saw the other day that was very notable. Crimes of the Heart by Bruce Burris for directing is going to be a winner, I'm sure, at the Academy Awards for different divisions. Now, one might be for directing for Bruce. Now, he hails from Australia. You'll recall he won the directing award for Tender Mercies. That was his first American film. Now, Crimes of the Heart is his third, and I think he's done it again. It stars Diane Keaton as a lady, an elder sister, Lenny McGrath, of the three sisters that are in this family, who feels that no man can love her because she has a shrunken ovary problem. Okay, now we start out with that and go on to Jessica Lange, who has had an unsuccessful career as a singing star and has a nervous breakdown related to her job now at a dog food factory. So, I mean, we're getting into the movie already about the kind of movie this is. And now Babe McGrath, the youngest, played by Sissy Spacek, is I think, the least cerebral of the bunch. And she does everything on the impulse. And she's very compulsive. And if she's had a bad day, well, she does kind of some bizarre things that, you know, might keep you kicking and watching that screen a little bit more closely. But it's an excellent movie. It's an excellent performance by all three girls. Now, this kind of movie is the new slice of life genre that has really become popular. And a lot of bittersweet comedy in it. It's very unconventional. Its photography is just excellent. Why don't we just take a look so you can see for yourself? I really, really enjoy that movie. I might see it again sometime. So if any of you want to go, there's a partner here you might want to go with if you want. Okay, now coming up, there's a lot of movies in town, and another one is The Golden Child with Eddie Murphy. And, you know, he's from the Beverly Hills Cop fame, and this is a fairly good movie. Now, I'm not so sure his comedy is up to par and everything, but it's an interesting movie, and it's lighthearted and fun. He's a man who has magical powers that'll save futures of generations, thousands of them, I guess. So it might be interesting for a nice light night out. Another one, of course, is the No Mercy by Richard Gere and Kim Basinger. And that's a good one, too. It's about a tough Chicago cop who falls in love with his enemy's girlfriend. So that could be an interesting triangle, too, to watch out for. But Richard Gere is pretty good, so let's see their performance. I think it should be good. Now, other things playing around town are the Human League. They'll be performing at Théâtre Saint-Denis. That'll be on the 27th of January at 8, and tickets are still available. I would suggest you phone there soon, though. We also have the Centaur Theatre Company with Fire, an evangelical rock musical. And that's playing from January 8th to February the 1st, and I think that's something else that you might want to look into. Overall, it's going to be a really busy month, so stay with us. I'm Shalini Goel, and stay tuned next week for CUSA Reps coming in about our Concordia Carnival. See you then.
Welcome to another rendezvous. Today we have another big lineup for you. We're going to talk about CUSA's big carnival coming up, and of course, St. Valentine's Day. In order to celebrate Hollywood's 100th birthday, our own way, we're going to decide to show you some of the latest clips of the movies showing around town. This may give you a chance to plan your special Valentine's Day evening. But first, Here's a Rendez-vous tribute to Hollywood stars.
In this business, two's not even a number, because nobody counts past one.
Well, movies have changed, but stars certainly haven't. Sunil is here today to tell us about a movie you have to watch out for. It's called Dead of Winter. So, Sunil, is it a thriller?
Yes, it's a new thriller by MGM, directed by Arthur Penn, who also directed Bonnie and Clyde. And let me tell you, it's really something special. It reminded me of the old British thrillers.
Mm-hmm.
Where they would set up a situation that was scary rather than using blood and gore to carry the film. In fact, Dead of Winter has very little blood or gore, but the situation the woman in the film gets into is terrifying.
Oh, great. So that's about what the storyline is all about,
well,
mostly?
The story is about a young actress who is asked to audition for a role in a film by Roddy McDowall. And the catch is that she'd be taking over a role of a woman who was brutally murdered. And when she goes to the director's house, who is played by Jeanne Roubs, she finds out that nothing is as simple as it seems. And I don't want to give too much of the film away, but I will say that these are not the type of people you would like to have a rendezvous with on a cold winter night, which is something Steam Virgin soon finds out.
Great.
As for twists and turns, this film has enough of them to keep any fan of the genre happy.
Great. How's the acting in the film?
Well, Steam Virgin is actually terrific. She displays a versatility in three different roles in the film. And McDowell, whose character is a send-up of Norman Bates in Psycho,
mm-hmm.
and Jeanne Roubs, who you might remember as the grandfather in Witness,
right.
are both so sinister they can send chills down your spine.
So this is a good movie for Friday the 13th.
Oh, yes. It's actually getting eerie in here. It's actually a good, scary movie, but the director, Arthur Penn, adds a good dose of humor in it.
And it's filmed entirely in Ontario, so it's a movie Canadians can be proud of.
Great. So I guess we're going to all watch out for that then. Instead of winter.
Definitely. Yeah.
Great. Well, folks, if you want to start thinking about St. Valentine's Day, here's a good overall look at what's playing in different movie houses around town right now. We'll take it away with a little segment now.
Good afternoon, Mr. Movie houses around town offer a big variety of movies this season. The king of comedy, Eddie Murphy, is back as the chosen one, whose task is to save the world and find the golden child.
Shut up!
A child has been kidnapped.
When?
5 days ago in northeastern Tibet.
Well, Tibet's a little bit out of my territory.
This child is special, Mr. Girel. His destiny is to save the world.
That's a good destiny.
400 years ago, the New Chong Oracle predicted that the Gompantama, that is Tibetan for golden child, would be taken to the new city, the city of the angels, and would be rescued by a man who is no angel.
And who's that?
You, Mr. Girel.
Yeah, right. Okay. I'm in the middle of a basketball game, although I'd love to stay and chat with you.
I realize it's very hard for you to take in. But it's your destiny to find the golden child.
And it's your destiny to seek some serious psychiatric help. Really? Excuse me? Can I go play now? Please? Go home? Excuse me. And such a cute girl, too.
It involves him on a fantastic odyssey that sweeps him from California to China.
Come to ask for the sacred cross dagger of Ajanti.
For what reason?
For the golden child.
Let him ask it.
I said, I want the knife.
Let him ask again.
I want the knife. Please.
They'll always find their place on the screen. In No Mercy, Richard Gere, a tough Chicago cop, falls in love with his only lead and sole witness, played by Kim Basinger. The mysterious backwater Louisiana swamps and streets of New Orleans are the setting for the dangerous world of violence and intrigue.
You're free. Sit your hands, get out of here.
Eddie, you have to talk to me. You have to talk to me right now. Come on, make a time. We have to talk to me. Just talk to me. Just for a while, talk to me.
You want
to
help me?
No.
Please, get out of here. Please.
I'm going. I won't let him kill you. Together we have a chance. I want a chance, Eddie. That's all I want. I love you. I want time.
I don't care about you!
What changes would you make given the opportunity to live your life over again? This thought becomes a dramatic possibility in Peggy Sue Got Married, now playing in French. Here, a wiser Kathleen Turner tells Nicholas Clay their relationship is over.
I've got the teeth, I've got the eyes. Oh, Peggy, look outside that window. I've got the car. I'm the lead singer. I'm the man. Why are you arguing with me?
It's over, Charlie. I don't want to hurt you. I want you to be happy.
But no, I will be happy if I have you. I love you.
No, that doesn't make any difference. We just can't live together. And you went off with that bimbo, Janet.
What are you talking about? Who is Janet?
I just can't trust you.
But what about everything I said to you this afternoon?
That's exactly what I'm talking about. It's like I have this window in my heart, and anytime you feel like it, you can just crawl right in. Well, I gotta close it, or nothing's ever gonna be different.
What has to be different?
Everything. You know it's not gonna work like this.
Children of a Lesser God, starring William Hurt and Marilee Matlin, is a strong contender in this year's Oscar race. It's a touching and romantic story between a deaf woman and a teacher.
Talk to her, okay? I mean, can we stop this? I mean, why can't we? I mean, why can't we just... Why don't we go out and have some dinner tonight? Huh? Just give me a yes or a no. Yes? Good. I think. Okay, I will meet you behind the girls' dormitory at 8 o'clock. And I will whisper your name. Hey, I know that sign. That's the first sign I ever learned.
Three movies starring young actors with very promising careers have begun playing in Montreal. From the Hip is a social comedy focusing on a young lawyer played by Judd Nelson.
You didn't find any fingerprints, did you?
No.
And does it seem strange that someone would be so careful to wipe away every single fingerprint and then leave the murder weapon in his car for someone to find?
Well, it's a little unusual.
Unusual? Isn't it possible that someone else put those items under the defendant's car seat?
It's possible. But why didn't he call the police? No, he knew the stuff was in the car. It was right under him.
Isn't it possible he didn't know?
He was sitting right over it, for Pete's sake.
So it would be ridiculous for him to have not known?
Absolutely.
Then it would be ridiculous for someone not to know that he was sitting over a caged rabbit.
Someone like you, Lieutenant Socha? It's all right. This is outrageous.
Is it? No telling what we'll find in Mr. Murray's trial bag.
Andrew McCarthy is back on the screen in a new movie called Mannequin. Here he's a shy stockroom clerk who creates a mannequin that comes to life.
What's the matter? Don't you like your new scarf?
Not especially. What a funny way to say hello.
What the hell's going on?
My name is Emma Hesaray, but you can call me Emmy.
This is a joke, right? Some sort of Prince and Company initiation? Who hired you, Hollywood?
Nobody hired me, Jonathan. You know who I am.
No, this can't be happening. I know the sign. The electricity? My brain synapse, it was destroyed.
I felt so sorry for you last night. You looked so lost and lonely.
Well, that's not you saw me? No, you can't be her.
When you were making me, didn't you feel a certain inspiration? Almost like your hands were being moved by a force not of this world. You made this body so that I could come to life.
So I said, am I the Twilight Zone or am I just nuts? I'm
so glad I picked you.
Hey, I'm gonna create someone who doesn't like me.
If psychological thrillers are your game, there's Black Widow with Deborah Winger and Teresa Russell. Winger's a young Justice Department investigator who gets obsessed with apprehending a beautiful woman who has a deadly obsession of her own. Seducing, marrying, and murdering wealthy men.
These are the best pictures you have.
She doesn't want pictures. She knows the camera's there. She turns away, I can tell.
The Texas one is different. She's got a slimmer body.
No, it's the way she stands.
She's younger, Alex, at least 5 years
That's
younger.
That's makeup, hair, attitude.
I think you're wrong.
I could be right.
Look, the whole MO, a complex series of seductions and murders, that's not something you see a woman do.
Oh, really? Which part you figure a woman isn't up to, the seduction or the murder? Look, I just want the field assignment. Please.
Listen, data analysis is the heart of what we do here, and the best work in this shop is yours. The best. It's a job you were born to do.
It's a job with green windows. Bruce, I've been in this office for 6 years, this damn government office with green windows.
Yeah, I know. You want excitement. Well, a lot of people don't look to get it all from their job.
Today, we have Robert Douglas, who is the organizer for this year's carnival, and he's going to tell us a little bit about what's going on. So, Robert, fill us in on what's going to happen.
Okay, well, basically, there should be a lot of fun, first of all.
We hope so, eh?
Yeah, there should be quite a bit. I've taken enough time to make sure of that. Carnival this year runs from February, next Wednesday, February 11th to the 14th. And it's just 4 days of jam-packed activities. It's reduced from last year because of the fact that I personally believe that the participation has not been too great, and that didn't really justify spending so much money on it.
What do you think the cause of that is? No participation.
Well, it's the general apathy in the school, first of all, and probably. that's our major problem at Concordia.
Exams too is all around the same time.
Exactly, yeah. Because originally it was supposed to have taken place the week before the break, and that wasn't a very good idea because that's when exams are. So
right.
I try to push it up and reduce it.
But we should be looking forward to some really good bashes this time?
Oh, yes. Every single day there's a bash, and on Friday and Saturday there are two bashes.
Okay, I want to know about this beer hunt one here.
Oh.
It was kind of interesting. Tell us about it.
Everyone has I've been asking me about that. The beer hunt basically is, we have 50 cases of beer.
Okay.
For this event, and we're going to stash it in the snow at Loyola.
Okay, how are we going to find these beers?
Oh, that's interesting. First of all, there's a map which could be found at the Loyola office. And it lists a couple of hints and clues, but generally we're going to dye, we're going to use clothes dye, or not clothes dye, but food dyes,
mm-hmm.
to color the snow, and you sort of poke under, you might find a bottle, you might even find a whole case.
So how do you win?
Well,
the
that's
more sloshed
it.
You are, the winner.
Whoever gathers the most beer, I guess, you know, there's no real winner. Some people might just go get one case and they might be happy for the rest of the day.
Are there any prizes or beer your prize?
Not for this event, no.
No? Okay, what event would take, would we get prizes after? Would be any kind of event?
Okay, there's a carnival mascot, which is at 12 p.m. And it's at Loyola. It's going to be judged in the campus center, in the cafeteria. And there are prizes for that.
Oh, that's good. What are the prizes?
We have mugs, we have hats, we have... T-shirts like this.
Those are nice. Those are not for sale then, right?
No, these are basically for people who volunteer, and I hope all you people do volunteer, or most of you. And it's free if you volunteer. And we do have T-shirts with the same print, but it's just a T-shirt, and it's being sold for $6.
Where can we get a T-shirt?
You could get a T-shirt at the Sir George office on the sixth floor, or Loyola, in the campus center, or downstairs in the games room.
Good. I want to ask you about this Peel Pub Eat Out,
which
is taking place Wednesday on February 11th.
Yeah, this is interesting. I sort of conned two people into doing this. it is a con. I hope they don't take me to court for this. Basically, it's one rep from CUSA, who is Craig McNamee,
okay.
Who's our finance VP, and the biggest person we have in CUSA, apparently. The ECA was supposed to have put up Dan Otola, but they have changed their mind because we would have creamed him. I mean, it's just new competition. So they have put up some huge monster. I don't know his name yet. I don't know if he has been named by his parents at all, but he's quite huge, about 6'2 or something, and his
monster.
Stomach is about, yeah, this wide. So they'll probably cream us, but we're going to put up a good fight.
But it's all in fun, really.
Yes, it is. And it's going to take place at the Peel Pub down on the one in Mezzanine of the restaurant. And it's going to be a spaghetti eating contest. We're going to be set up on the stage, and you know, we're going to play the rocking music when we walk in, of course, and so on.
Oh, that's going to be a lot of fun. I hope a lot of people turn out for that.
I hope so, too. I think it'll be, you know, an interesting thing.
And on Valentine's Day, what are we going to have? Anything romantic and special?
There's the usual beach party, which is usually sold out. And we have real sand and palm trees, but the palm trees are plastic palm trees. We couldn't bring in the real ones.
Oh, that's too bad.
It costs too much. But it has been really sold out. There's going to be sand all over the place. And normally you don't wear any shoes. You just go in and kick it, you know, wherever you want, and it'll be all dance floor, there'll be all sand and everything. And what you were required, you know, you'd bring your own beach ball, towels, you know, copper tone, and, you know, shark repellent.
Yeah, shark repellent. Ladies out there, I think they mean it's a repellent against men, for those pains who don't leave you alone. So they ask for shark repellent, okay. And after the same day, I see there's a cultural clash.
Yeah, the cultural clash replaces the jam down, which we had last year, jam down the second. Which was interesting because the band members were sort of smashed and they were not able to play apparently. But this year, hopefully they'll get smashed afterwards. And it's last year was just a reggae show period, just a couple of reggae bands. Now this year it's called a cultural clash, being organized partly by CAPS, which is the Canadian Association for the Advancement of People.
Okay.
And it's basically round two. Last week was round one. This week features Ray Kondo, 3 o'clock train, and Jack Carter and Determination.
Good band.
So that should be, yeah, it's right upstairs in the Sir George cafeteria.
So then we should be looking for something really special this year.
That's right.
According to our schedule.
Hopefully.
So, Robert, I think you worked really hard at this, and I hope a lot of people turn out for it.
I hope so, too.
Okay, thanks a lot for coming.
Thanks for having me.
I'm going to be there this year, I swear.
You will.
I swear I'll be there.
I'll hold you down to that.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
It's been very nice, but I just want to ask you one question. What exactly is this?
I don't know. I will have to ask the prop man.
It sort of looked like
dough. Well, maybe we'll ask Brian after the show.
Baked doughs or something.
Yeah. And our plant has been growing really fast with these lights.
Yeah, here. Especially since it's plastic.
Yeah, yeah. It's magic plants. Anyway.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks a lot for coming.
Okay.
And we'll see you this week, hopefully.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, for those who want to offer a special gift to your Valentine, or for those who can't afford to go to New York on spring break, just like I can't afford, there is a chance for you to have a taste of a Broadway musical here in our city. It may not be romantic enough for Valentine's Day, but we'll take a look at it. It's called Pump Boys and Dinettes at Centaur Theater.
Looking for a fun night out? Well, Pump Boys and Dinettes is here at Centaur Theater from February 6th to the 22nd. It's an exciting musical with a rousing blend of assorted music, country, blues, gospel, rockabilly, blended together, the tale of a life in a roadside diner and gas station. Under the direction of Patrick Rose, Pump Boys and Dinettes stars 6 members of a Charlottetown festival cast. After 2 years in New York and a Tony Award nomination for Best Broadway Musical in 1982, a CBS recording contract, and an NBC TV special, Montrealers have the pleasure of witnessing this wonderful show here in our own city. Tickets are now on sale from $12.50 to $18.50 at Ticketron or Centaur Theatre, 453 Saint-François-Xavier in Old Montreal. Pump Boys and Dinettes is a wonderful way to spend an evening, an hour and a half with your sweetheart, and it'll be a great time. This has been Rendez-vous, Lori Lombardo saying goodbye.
Tell us about a French play that she has just recently seen. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yes, so I went to see Pierre Verville at Club Soda. Okay. So for those who don't know him, he's an impersonator. And in his new show, he's making fun of around 50 people, mostly singer, radio announcers, TV hosts, and other well-known figure of the Québécois
showbiz. I hope they're not making fun of the Rendez-vous team.
No, the satire of the media doesn't include Rendez-vous.
Thank God. For now.
For now. So on stage, Verville is surrounded by a huge ghetto blaster and a giant TV set. And the rhythm of the show is very good. It's never interrupted. So there's always something going on, even when he's off stage. Say it's because mostly because of when he's off stage, there's some videos of him made by him who are playing while he's dressing up. So it makes a good rhythm of the piece.
So it's totally entertaining. You're never bored. It's
always never
moving.
Stop. That's right. So one of the best for me, one of the best of those video was when he impersonates Norman Brathwaite. You know, the one who does the milk advertising.
Oh yeah.
And it's used as a leitmotif, so it comes over and over again several times in the show. And the joke is saying that more than just drinking milk, he sniffs powdered milk. You know? So the first part of the show is more, I say, light. Like he's making fun, for example, of Montréal en direct, mm-hmm. You know, hosted by Pierre Marcotte. I should say it's not very hard to laugh at him, though. And so for me, Verville is better at singing than when he's in impersonations. Like is the one of Fernand Gignac, Robert Charlebois, Francis Cabrel, and many others by this gesture and the lyrics, because he changed them, for sure. And the voices are very, very impressive. And the second part of the show begins with a voice post-synchro with a film of Woody Allen. Okay. So what he impersonates him with admiration. Actually, the technique used here is a real innovation. The TV set gives the image of Woody Allen and a woman, and Verville gives the sound. So it's very, very interesting.
So it's comical. It's more funny than
Is. Yeah, it is all funny. But I should say that the second part is more like subtle, more like deeper humor, I should say. Mm-hmm. And the first part is more like free humor, easy, you know, easy jokes.
Would you suggest a play like this for English people, even if it is a French play?
Yeah, I would. It's actually it's not a French play. It's a one-man show, okay? Mm-hmm. But Verville got a very good sense of the space. He uses the space, the whole stage, very well, and we don't get the static mm-hmm. feeling of a great number of one-man show. And I can suggest it for English people because the texts are not very hard to understand. But the only problem I see is that maybe to find it funny, you have to know the person which is being impersonized. Right. And I guess many people won't know all of them. Yeah. So
we're not too many English people are not familiar with French actors or
yeah, and like guests that. And all those.
That's good. So then it's a good show then, and yeah, I recommend it.
Yeah, actually, I recommend it you should see for the supplementaries now. And I recommend it for everybody who wants to have a nice evening in the company of one of our most promising Québécois artists.
Very good. Okay, so now we're going to tell you about what's going around in town right now on the weekends. We've got The Merchant of Venice by Shakespeare at Dome Theater. Tickets are $5 for students, so that should be really good.
And for the French, pour les Français, il y a des supplémentaires pour la pièce La Trilogie des Dragons, mise en scène de Robert Lepage, une des stars de la LNI. C'est l'histoire de trois quartiers chinois, un gros succès du World Stage Festival de Toronto, du 11 au 14 février au théâtre d'aujourd'hui. C'est aussi la dernière fin de semaine pour aller voir La Double Inconstance de Marivaux, un classique présenté au théâtre du Nouveau Monde.
Okay, we have Somebody's Returning at the Centaur Theater starting February 5th to the 22nd of March. So that you should look out for.
Mardi le 17 février au Spectrum, il y aura l'enregistrement de Samedi de rire à 20h et les billets sont gratuits. Aussi, au Café de la Place, il y a une intéressante production qui s'appelle Tchekhov-Tchekova. C'est du célèbre auteur russe Anton Tchekhov et c'est jusqu'au 7 mars.
And we have to mention again that the Concordia Carnival will be taking place this week, and no one should miss it. It's going to be very entertaining. It'll be running from the 11th to the 14th.
Aussi, un groupe rock soviétique appelé Autographe donnera un concert sûrement mémorable du 11 au 13 février prochain au Spectrum. Et pour finir, Rock et Belles Oreilles est de retour sur la scène du Spectrum de Montréal du 19 au 21 et du 25 au 28 février à 20h. Les cinq Rock et Belles Oreilles sont bientôt à leur 100e représentation. Vous les avez sûrement vus à la station 4 saisons ou entendus à C'est quoi avec leur grand succès Arrête de boire. Mais rien ne les remplace sur scène. Billets en vente au Spectrum, $16.50.
Well, I guess that's it for now, Marie-Hélène, right? I hope you and your sweetheart have a great time this Valentine's Day. And because of the special romantic weekend coming up, we have a special cartoon surprise for you with a lot of love in it. Thank you very much. We'll see you next time. And next week we'll have a review of Light of Day with Joan Jett and Michael J. Fox. Bye-bye.
Welcome to another rendezvous. I hope you all enjoyed your break. During that time, our crew went to find out what was the most interesting to be doing this spring for entertainment. Today, we have a guest, Sue, to tell us about Light of Day. Hello, Sue.
Hi. Okay, Light of Day is a new film by Paul Schrader, and this man's been responsible for films like Blue Collar, American Gigolo, Cat People, Mishima, Taxi Driver, Raging Bull, and a score of others. And this is a script, it's a pet project of his that he's had lying around for about 6 years. And at the beginning it was called Born in the USA until Bruce Springsteen kind of ripped off that title. So he felt a bit guilty about doing that. So he wrote a song for Schrader, which is used in the film. It's called Just Around the Corner to the Light of Day. And the title was shortened to Light of Day, and so we've got our movie. And it features Michael J. Fox as Joe, Gina Rowlands as the mother, Joan Jett as Patty, and Joan Jett's making her screen debut. Jason Miller as the father, and Michael McKean, which some people might remember, he was Thick Lenny in Laverne and Shirley, and a really cute kid called Billy Sullivan as Patty's son Benji, 5-year-old kid. He's really cute. And what's happening in this movie is it's a family drama, a little bit like Ordinary People meets music, you know, and Michael J. Fox tries to keep together the family, and what's happening is Patty is into this rock and roll, and she's, you know, her mother thinks she's an unfit mother because she has this illegitimate child, and the mother's into religion, so you have, like, you know, they're kind of dueling, you know, Michael J. Fox trying to keep the family together, and the movie is in Cleveland. And what I've really liked about the movie is that the director puts no colors. It's all, you know, very gloomy, realistic. You get out of the movie, you almost feel like it's a documentary, you know? There's no gloss at all. And though the movie is being, it's being promoted as if it's a movie about Michael J. Fox, but I came out of the movie thinking that he had like a secondary role to the mother and Patty, you know, dueling it out together.
How about we go for a clip?
Maybe we can go for a clip. In this clip, what's happening is that the mother has custody of the child, and Patty wants the child back, and you kind of see, you know, how she, you know, in the movie you start wondering if she really likes her child or not, and in this scene you understand that she does, you know. So we can go for the clip.
Not with her. I really love Benji. You know.
I know.
I admit I ain't been the best mother. That thing in Michigan was really stupid. Sorry. You know, I could have had an abortion and Mom would have never found out. Sometimes I wonder, what would happen if I had? I'm a good singer, Joey.
You are.
Yeah, but then I look at Benji and I get so full of feelings. I just want to hit myself for thinking that way. I was so young, you know? I wanted something that was mine, something she had no part of.
Sounds very interesting. What else is there about it?
Okay, you have to know that this is the first role that Michael J. Fox has had that doesn't have to do with comedy. It's a drama, and I feel that he really did well in it. You know, it's his first time, and that he does something like this. He's got maybe 3 lines that are funny in the whole movie. But Joan Jett comes off really good in this movie because she's got a better role, more interesting than what Michael J. Fox has to deal with. And also, I found that she had a really intense screen presence, which, you know, it's very good for her first movie. Another thing that I found that Paul Schrader did very well is that instead of having the actors lip sync to the music, because they are a bar band, you know, and he wanted to make it look very realistic, so it's really live. The music is live. There's no lip syncing. I mean, we've seen a lot of lip syncing on Much Music and MTV, and we know it's fake, and we can tell when it's fake. And in this movie, you see it. It's there, mistakes and all. And Michael J. Fox comes off as a pretty good guitarist. He can handle himself. That was kind of nice to see. And so I would recommend it. I would give it an 8 out of 10.
8 out of 10, yeah. For a lot of music and a lot of drama.
Yeah, it's for people who like drama, mostly.
Thank you, Sue. We went to Le Rendez-vous du Cinéma Québécois this year to meet the latest producers about their latest movie. Of course, there was a little tribute to be paid to the recent success of Le Déclin in Europe. Now, let's take a look.
Le Rendez-vous du Cinéma Québécois, une rétrospective annuelle complète, célébrait cette année son 5e anniversaire. L'événement coïncidait avec l'annonce officielle de la nomination du Déclin de l'Empire américain pour l'Oscar du meilleur film étranger. Mais détrompez-vous, les rendez-vous avaient quelques 73 autres films à honorer et à cet effet, de nombreux intervenants du milieu cinématographique s'étaient réunis. Nous avons rencontré deux de ces réalisateurs. D'abord, André Mélenchon, qui a réalisé les grands succès La guerre des tuques et Bac et bottine, et tout récemment, Le lys cassé, un film traitant de l'inceste.
C'est évident que bon, c'est très différent de La guerre des tuques et de Bac et bottine. C'est moins différent de ce que j'avais touché sur le film Les vrais perdants, par exemple. Bon, c'est évident que Les vrais perdants, c'est pas un film sur des enfants qui ont subi l'inceste, mais c'est quand même un film sur des enfants qui souffrent, qui sont jusqu'à un certain point victimes, disons. Je l'ai fait comme un film déclencheur. C'est-à-dire comme oui, c'est, j'espère que ce film-là va être vu par bon, des enfants, mais surtout des mères et aussi des pères. Et la seule chose que j'espère, c'est que ça puisse provoquer des réflexions. J'ai pas voulu faire un procès avec Le lys cassé. Le pire compliment qu'on peut me faire, c'est quand je fais des films sur les enfants, c'est de dire les enfants, c'est cute. Hein? C'est parce que c'est pas vrai, c'est pas juste cute. Il y a des douleurs chez les enfants. Et je pense que c'est aussi important de montrer la douleur chez un enfant que sa joie de vivre. Et pour moi, Le lys cassé, à ce moment-là, est un beau pendant à Bac et bottine, à La guerre des tuques. Il y a d'autres choses chez les enfants et il faut être aussi présent à ça aussi. Il faut pas avoir peur.
Voici maintenant Paul Baillargeon qui a réalisé Sonia, un film sur la maladie d'Alzheimer.
Peut-être c'est plus difficile quand on est une femme, mais peut-être c'est plus intéressant aussi d'être une femme aujourd'hui. Parce que les défis sont très grands, on est neuve, on a tout à découvrir, tout à faire, c'est passionnant. On n'a pas une longue histoire derrière nous, mais on n'est pas écrasé par elle parce qu'on la connaît pas, on n'est pas... faire ce film-là, ce qui était difficile, c'était pas que j'étais une femme, c'était que c'était un film sur un sujet médical et c'était comme... Il y avait comme une aura autour de ça que ça allait être plate parce que c'était un film médical.
Pourtant, ses efforts ont été récompensés puisque son film Sonia remportait, au terme des rendez-vous, le prix du meilleur moyen métrage.
Well, we all congratulate Denis Arcand on his success, and we wish that all the other directors have the same success with their new movies. Recently, there's been a lot of fun happening on the mezzanine of the Hall building, and here to speak with us today we have a guest, Jacques Lamarche. Hello, Jackie.
Hi.
Would you tell us what's happening on the mezzanine during the month of March?
Week by week?
Sure.
The first week, the second, third, and fourth, we have the Portuguese Students Association, Cultural Days, and the fifth and sixth, we have the Mauritian Students Association.
Does that promise any dancing?
The Portuguese traditionally have a very exciting exhibition, and it's a tradition in the Portuguese community of Montreal. Grandparents come and parents, and it's a quite exciting.
Okay, what's in the third week?
The second week, Radio St. George is having 3 days dedicated to the media, and the 12 and 13 we have the Muslim Students Association.
Oh, that sounds inspiring. What are they going to talk about?
The Muslim?
Yes.
It will be more directed towards religion information. They present us why they believe, and it's very, very interesting.
Okay, then you have CUSA.
The third week, the 16, 17, and 18, we have CUSA. It's Week of Action, anti-apartheid throughout North America. It will be very informative, and they have several guest speakers lined up for that particular. Actually, it will be 3 days because they were very generous. They gave up 2 of their dates for the Iranian Students Association in order that they have a place to celebrate the New Year's. They had nowhere to go.
So the Iranian New Year comes in the third week of March?
That's right, the 19th and the 20th.
Okay, and then we have...
The last week is the Design Students Association, and that is a big... it's our graduate students in design within the Faculty of Fine Arts, and they show us the most important designs, people that have won prizes and so on. Many of the billboards you see in Montreal, Air Canada, Peekaboo Shoe Company, were done by our students, our design students. It's very... and then there's only 2 days left in March, and one of those dates, the 31st, is reserved to the Concordia Animal Rights Association, which was just formed and is brand new.
So there's a day free in March?
One date. Anybody interested, call me.
Okay.
That's all.
What's in April then?
April, the first week, we have Urban Studies Students Association. That promises to be on urbanization, the new look of Montreal. That is supposed to be very, very interesting and informative. And the 3 days left before exam begin are reserved for LL Students Association, the 6th, 7th, and 8th of April.
And then it's reserved for studies periods.
Sacred study space for the students of Concordia from 8 in the morning to 11 at night until May the 2nd. Nobody's allowed in the mezzanine but our students.
7 days a week.
7 days a week.
Thank you very much, Jackie. Bye. Well, it's sometimes very surprising to see what we can see on campus in and around it. Actually, there's a few comedy nests now on Bishop Street. What's a comedy nest? Well, let's go and find out. Here is a segment with comedy nests at Bishop's on Friday nights and Saturday nights.
Hold this like this.
All right.
Hold that like that.
Okay.
Then I go like this.
Good.
Then go like this again. What's inside of that?
Nothing.
What's inside of that? Here we go. Hold this like this. Hold that like that. Now go like this. Ew!
That's good enough.
Ew! Ew!
Yes.
Ew!
Ew!
Ew! Ew! Patoom!
Patoom!
No, patoom.
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 Patoom. Patoom. Patoom. I go like this, go patoom.
Patoom.
I go one.
Well, one.
Two.
Two.
What?
Three.
Now lift up that.
Bilingual.
Lift up that. No, it's supposed to be like this. Get this like this. You got that like that? Is this like this? Sure, baby.
Okay.
So I guess now go one.
One.
Two.
Two.
Three.
Three.
Lift up that.
Then.
No, it's supposed to be like this. You're doing it wrong. Get.
Because that's how they talk over there. Entertainment. Who played Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz? Let me see. That was Shirley Temple, right? No, that was Judy Garland. Shirley Temple, Judy Garland, they all look the same to me.
I think if they want to cut down on drunk driving, and I think they should actually, they're going about it the wrong way. What is it now, $1,000 first offense? Big deal, when that happens to me, I just cash in my empties. I keep a lot of cases of empties around the house. I call it my impaired insurance. But I think if they want to cut down on drunks for real, they should have some really weird laws. They should have laws like drunks only on these streets. Little drunk routes all over town. Have little beer bottle signs showing them the way. Rubber curbs. Have the minimum speed 150 miles an hour. 9-degree turn every block. And kill them all in a week.
Well, that sounds certainly good enough to replace the traditional movie night. There is another one to be seen, which is The Good Wife. Here we have Natalie to talk about The Good Wife.
Well, The Good Wife is not really a thriller, neither a suspense, nothing of these things. It's a really confusing movie. Well, first of all, I have to say it stars this gorgeous girl, Rachel Ward, that we all saw in The Thornbirds. And she's also co-starring with her is her real-life husband, Brian Brown, that's his name. He was also in the Thornbirds. It's not at all like Crocodile Dundee, unfortunately. Crocodile Dundee was a big hit this year. It was a comedy. But this movie is not a comedy. We should take it seriously, and yet it's not at all. It's not funny, it's not dramatic, it's like in between of it, it's lost. It's really stupid. First of all, there's no story. I mean, not any interesting story. It's absolutely unimaginative. It's all so predictable. There's this husband, he's rough, he's tough, he's macho. He's like, he's got all the worst things in the world for him. He's not even, to my point of view, gorgeous or whatever. And she is also stupid, she's innocent, she doesn't know what she wants. She's got all the stereotypes of how women are usually portrayed in movies, especially that one is so bad. Well, actually, we're going to take a look at the clip because you're going to see what it's like.
That bad.
Yeah.
She's a tart. And wasn't it you who tried to make one?
Well, don't pick on me just because you don't know what to do.
It's just some silly fancy that's got hold of her.
Well, you needn't worry about Neville because he can't stand the sight of her.
Well, that sums him up, doesn't it?
You really don't know what to do, do you?
It's full of cliches. The script is very badly written, so I don't really recommend the script unless you really want to see Rachel Ward on screen again. But from my point of view, she's better off with Priest in the Thornbirds than she is with this guy.
To wrap up, we have a video from the Pretenders, which are coming to the Forum on March 17th.
Thank
actually.
You.
So see you.
Bye.
I see neon lights.
Welcome to another Rendezvous. I'm Shalini Goel. And, you know, today, since this is our last segment of Rendezvous for the season, we have a great lineup of terrific events and things coming up this year for you. Just everything, you name it. Coming up now, the difficult thing to choose was which shows to put on, but we've got now a student presentation coming up to give you an idea of how our shows are put together. It's from our own members of CUTV, Concordia University Television Station. So let's take a look.
Concordia University Television is a student-run club sponsored by CUSA for the purpose of providing information and entertainment for Concordia's 20,000 students. Originally called Television Sir George, it was initiated in 1967 by a group of students who wanted to gain hands-on experience in the medium of television. CUTV is located on the sixth floor of the Hall building. Their goal is to allow students in any faculty of Concordia participate in Canada's only university-run television station. Presently, CUTV has 120 volunteer members and 30 active members who participate in the broad range of a complete television production. The station is guided by 5 executives who are elected by members on a yearly basis. These jobs include executive producer, station manager, station coordinator, public relations director, and program director. And remember, you do not have to have taken a TV production course to become a member.
CUTV programs within the confines of the St. George Williams campus on a closed circuit system. CUTV provides a diverse programming schedule ranging from Star Trek to movies to their own home productions. The local productions make up approximately 50% of the programming seen by its audience. CUTV is on air Monday to Thursday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Friday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. What we see on the screen is a polished final product. However, what's not seen is the amount of hard work and dedication that goes into making it. CUTV utilizes the studio of the audiovisual department. This allows members to work in a professional studio while gaining experience in every stage of production, be it camera, lighting, editing, writing, or staging. These productions are later edited and the final touches given. Different types of programming are produced by CUTV. Sporting events, entertainment shows, live newscasts, rock videos, and conferences. CUTV also adds to their list 5 professional summer co-productions with CFCF 12, Our City, Future Scope, Montreal Inside Out, Art Beat, and Montreal Profile.
Gets another goal, and that was just about the same location as the first goal.
Bonjour. Aujourd'hui, c'est avec ma propre voix que j'aimerais vous entretenir d'un sujet qui me tient à cœur.
Bonjour.
Bonjour, Monsieur Moreau.
Bonjour, Mademoiselle.
Ça revient ce matin?
Oui. T'es à l'air en forme dangereusement.
Oui. T'es belle à parler de ça.
Ben,
oui.
CUTV, a student-run television station for the students of Concordia.
Well, that's one example of one of the productions, some of the productions that have been put on by CUTV over the last year. There's a lot of work that we don't see on air. We see the talent. We're lucky to have really, really good people here. But, you know, 9/10 of the work is done behind the scenes, so we give a lot of thanks to those people that put in so much during that time. Okay, well, you know, believe me, for this show, the hardest thing was choosing what was actually going to be put on for this show. There's just so much going on in Montreal and around. One of these fine things going on around Montreal is an award-winning comedy. And Marie Danielle, do you have something to tell us about this beautiful play being put on?
Yes, I went to see The Real Thing. It's written by Tom Stoppard, and he also wrote Enter a Free Man and Night and Day. Most of his work has been staged at the Centaur.
Mm-hmm. So what did you think of the performance? Did you like it?
Well, The Real Thing is basically it's an outlook on the modern love. And there's two couples of yuppies, and they learn, you know, the difficult way. They learn the difficult way how love experience is acquired. They go through many situations. They're being cheated on. They're cheating on their lover. Just about everything. They break commitments. Just about everything they can do, they mm-hmm. do.
Daily student life soap opera.
And in the second act, there's a couple of yuppies that has to see their 15-year-old daughter leave. And, of course, they would like to hold her back. They'd like to protect her. But of course, she has to learn her own way, and the real thing has to be learned by each different person. Mm-hmm. I must admit that I have a few reservations. The play was good, the acting was good. The rhythm doesn't flow that well. It's broken a little bit, it's shaky. Also, they use a British accent. I don't know why in Canada, mm-hmm. here in
especially.
Montreal.
Yeah, that's not very necessary. Maybe the original idea was to have it played in Britain, or was it written by a British author?
It is a British author, oh, well. But you can miss a few of the jokes if they're if you're not tuned to that accent. So
well, they have a different sense of humor too from the Canadians.
Yeah, the Canadians.
We're very typical.
So in spite of that, it's a good idea to stop at the Centaur. It's a charming little theater. It's in Old Montreal. It's near the Metro Place d'Armes. And if I could make you a suggestion for a romantic evening,
oh, please do.
Okay.
Just about now.
Go to Old Montreal, a nice fine restaurant very close to the Centaur. Then you go for a play. Then you go for a carriage ride in the Old Montreal streets, and you bring the bottle of champagne along. That's a refreshing idea for spring.
Where's the summer season when you need it?
Right okay. at the door.
Well, but do you have a clip for us, Marie Danielle?
No, I don't. Unfortunately, we don't have a clip on this one.
Well,
sorry,
Shalini, okay.
You have to go and see it.
All right. Well, and I think that would definitely be worth a visit since we're not going to get any sneak previews out there for you guys either. I have to suffer along. We'll go and see it. Okay. Well, now talking about recognition and awards, we have some previews of the nominations coming up for the annual Academy Awards. You know, that's going to be coming up on the 30th, though. So let's have our own Oscar preview coming up.
Will the big winner be Hannah and Her Sisters, Children of a Lesser God, or The Mission? I'm Sunil Mitani.
Hi, and I'm Shalini Goel with you again. Who's going to win the most number of Oscars this year? We're here to take a look at some of the previews of the upcoming nominations for the 59th Annual Academy Awards taking place this March the 30th. So, Sunil, should we begin with the Best Picture category?
War and Romance are what the nominations for Best Picture are all about. Oliver Stone's Platoon is about a young soldier's experience in Vietnam.
Platoon is nominated in 8 categories and is tied with James Ivory's film. Together they lead the Oscar race. A Room with a View is a romance set in Edwardian England.
Oh, yes, look away.
Also nominated is Woody Allen's Hannah and Her Sisters, a film about changing relationships. Children of a Lesser God is a romance of a different kind, that of a hearing-impaired woman with her speech teacher.
Stupid hearing people think that deaf people are stupid.
The Mission is a historical drama that pits the man of the cloth against the man of the sword. It takes place in the jungles of South America.
Might is right.
love has no place in the world. Maybe so, maybe so. But I don't have the strength to live in a world like that, Rodrigo.
The competition is very strong this year in the acting categories. I'll be telling you about the actresses in a little while, but Shalini, first tell us about the men.
Well, you know, James Woods is a surprise choice this year. You might recall he played the soldier in Salvador.
Also nominated are jazz great Dexter Gordon, making his acting debut in Around Midnight.
They're always paying all the wrong people in this world.
Paul Newman receives his 7th career nomination for playing a pool shark in The Color of Money.
Both arms in traction, he beats anybody in the room.
Yeah. Yeah, he could.
So I'll offer it to you again. I'll play him for $500.
William Hurt, who won last year's award for Kiss of the Spider-Woman, now plays a teacher in Children of a Lesser God. Bob Hoskins won this year's Best Actor Award at Cannes Film Festival for his role as a thug with a heart of gold in Mona Lisa.
Really takes talent.
Some women are whores, some whores are black. You take what you're given, don't you?
In competition for Best Actress are four of Hollywood's biggest stars and a newcomer. Heading the biggies is Jane Fonda, who plays an alcoholic in The Morning After. While Sigourney Weaver is nominated as Sergeant Ripley battling aliens once again, Sissy Spacek shoots and Kathleen Turner tries to change her future in Peggy Sue Got Married.
It's over, Charlie. I don't want to hurt you. I want you to be happy.
The newcomer is Marlee Matlin, who joins her acting partner William Hurt and gives a powerful performance as a death student in Children of a Lesser God.
But you think for me, think for Sarah, as though there were no I. She will be with me. Quit her job. Learn how to play poker. Leave Oren's party. Learn how to speak. That's all you, not me.
Marlee Matlin, Kathleen Turner, and Sigourney Weaver are all first-time nominees in this category. Now, Shalini, isn't there another first in the Canadian film industry this year?
Well, you all know what I'm going to say next. It's our own Quebec film, you know, written by Denis Arcand, the director, and that's The Decline of the American Empire. Now, that's up for the Best Foreign Film Award, so let's watch out for that. I think that'll be a really great hit. You remember that racy film about the female-male relationships? Watch out for that. I have a feeling we might make it this year.
Here, the women discuss a party while working out at the gym.
C'est un peu bizarre. D'abord, ils attendent que tout le monde soit arrivé. Puis là, on est passé au sous-sol. C'était assez grand, tapis très épais, beaucoup de divans, beaucoup de coussins, les lumières basses. Ils ont mis un film porno sur le vidéocassette. Puis là, les gens ont commencé à danser un peu. En fait, c'était pas vraiment de la danse. C'était plutôt du plotage vertical.
Decline of the American Empire is up against Betty Blue from France, The Assault from the Netherlands, My Dear Little Village from Czechoslovakia,
and 38 from Austria. You know, Sunil, The Assault won the Golden Globe Award for Best Foreign Film category. So let's see what's going to happen next with The Decline of the American Empire. You know, they might be facing some stiff competition.
Well, we wish Decline and its director, Denis Arcand, our best of luck.
Absolutely.
That ends our preview of the Oscar nominations for this year. We'll be crossing our fingers and watching them Monday night.
Stay tuned. Until then,
I'm Sunil Mitani.
I'm Shalini Goel. Talk to you later. Choice for the nominations. That was pretty good, so we'll have to wait for the results. Now to get back into spring again, we've got that spirit in the air, it's the fever and everything, and I know summer's not very far away, and we have a guest here today to tell us a little bit more about what you could be doing this summer. We have Graham Richardson. Welcome to the show, Graham.
Thank you for inviting me.
Okay, well, we're very happy to have you here because you've got something that maybe a lot of students out there would be interested in hearing about, and it's SWAP. It's a student work exchange program.
SWAP is Student Work Abroad program.
Okay.
And it's a program which was created by CFS, Canadian Federation of Students, based in Toronto, and the student lobby group across Canada. And it's a job creation program for students who wish to have a working holiday experience in a foreign land.
Mm-hmm. So which countries are involved in this program now? Are there specific areas that you can go to? Or
we have six specific areas of the world. Britain is our most popular program, mm-hmm. being a Commonwealth country and not too expensive to get to. Mm-hmm. Ireland also, and the British Isles, which combines the two. Then we go down under to Australia and New Zealand, and to Asia this year with Japan and our newest destination, Swap France.
Now, so how would one go about applying into this program? Now, you're at Travel Cuts.
Yes, the program itself has been in existence for over 15 years, and it is sold through the Travel Cuts offices across Canada. Mm-hmm. It is available only to Canadian citizens. Mm-hmm. And because of the simple fact that they need working visas for most of these destinations and therefore need a Canadian passport, which we do all the services as far as that's concerned, is getting the working visa, and that's one of the things that SWAP provides to the student. It is not a guaranteed job program, it is not a career-oriented job program. That is up to the discretion of the actual applicant, whether or not they apply in their field once they are abroad.
Mm-hmm. It's just an experience.
It's the experience of what a better way than to learn about the country you're living in than to work with the people alongside mm-hmm. of them.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you have to be a student to apply, or?
Preference is always given to full-time students on mm-hmm. the SWAP program. In some countries, there are age restrictions on the visa mm-hmm. from the government. It's not SWAP, it's the government itself that issues the visa that restricts them. For example, Britain, 27 and under this year. Australia is 25 and under. New Zealand 30 and under, and so on. And part-time students are considered, depending on the number of applicants. And for Britain, there would be no problem since we have an unlimited amount of visas that we can issue.
How long would you go for to any one of these areas? Now, do you get to pick the length of stay that you would have?
Yes and no. Mm-hmm. Britain, you pick your date, but you would have to leave before the beginning of September since our SWAP office closed in mid-September. But mm-hmm. you can continue working there through the winter. Some people have gone and never come back.
Oh.
Your working visa can be extended. Australia is a six-month visa, which can be extended. New Zealand is a six-month visa for our spring departure and a three-month for our fall departure, and it cannot be renewed. Mm-hmm. Japan, the same thing. France is about the most restrictive, and it's a mid-June departure until the end of August, and that's mm-hmm. the end of the visa.
Well, what kind of a job, Graham, are you talking about when you say we could go there on a work abroad program? Now, for example, if I wanted to go to New Zealand, and that sounds exciting to me.
Shearing sheep.
Oh, dear.
We all know there's more sheep in New Zealand than people. Or working in a ski resort if you're there during their winter. That's very popular jobs.
Now, you don't provide the jobs, say.
No. The student travel office in that particular country mm-hmm. Would help us in assisting our clients over there to find jobs, direct them in a way of finding accommodations, where to apply, where to avoid, seedy areas, good mm-hmm, areas to mm-hmm. be in.
So you'd be helping them that way. Would there be any help financially?
No. Financially, there are fees for the inscription into each program, and it ranges from $130 to $200, depending on the country, depending on what's included. Sometimes there's accommodation included, the cost of the visa, etc. And they also have to pay for their own airline ticket. Mm-hmm. In some cases, like Australia, we have group departures, so it's actually less expensive than the average student rate to
Australia.
So
there are benefits towards going with Definitely. The SWAP program versus on your own.
Exactly.
Well, thanks a lot. That sounds very exciting and interesting alternative to working your way through before rather than during your holidays. It might be a longer stay for you, too. Thanks again, Graham.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, you know, that was for spring, and spring is in the air, but, you know, we have something else to show you, and that's going into summer, and I'm sure you're in the mood now for summer after our little discussion here, and that's Stravinsky's performance being played at La Place des Arts, and it's called Le Sacre du Printemps. It's a very cozy lunch hour show, very intimate, and you just love it. It's something to get away to. Let's check it out.
La Place des Arts présente avec fierté la seconde tranche des arts de la place, organisé par son service d'animation sous la responsabilité de M. Henri Barras, directeur artistique. Les arts de la place permettent aux Montréalais de profiter pendant la semaine ou durant le week-end d'une halte midi et de passer d'agréables moments avec de grands artistes et créateurs. J'ai rencontré M. Barras qui s'est fait un plaisir de nous expliquer ses heures d'animation.
Alors, les heures de la place, il y a plusieurs activités qui prennent place au piano nobilé de la salle Wilfrid Pelletier. C'est ce grand espace vitré qui est à l'entrée de la salle Wilfrid Pelletier, qui peut accueillir de 500 à 600 personnes qui viennent s'asseoir tranquillement sur le tapis ou sur les marches et qui apportent leur lunch ou qui peuvent apporter leur lunch. Donc ce sont les activités qui ont lieu durant l'heure du lunch, de midi à 1h. Le mercredi, nous faisons place à la musique classique. Le jeudi, c'est l'art du mouvement, c'est donc toutes les formes de danse, d'expression corporelle, au ballet, à la danse contemporaine. Le vendredi, nous faisons place à l'art lyrique. Le samedi matin, nous avons des concerts que l'on appelle concerts puces, qui sont donnés pour les enfants, des concerts d'initiation à la musique. Et le dimanche, nous avons également des concerts pour la famille, c'est-à-dire les parents et les enfants. Et tous ce sont des spectacles, des concerts ou des programmes donc, de danse. On peut y voir un spectacle de danse, mais tous ces spectacles et toutes ces activités sont commentés. On explique aux gens, comme aujourd'hui nous avons vu le Sacre du printemps de Stravinsky, mis en chorégraphie par Martine Époque, et on explique au public comment on fait au fond une chorégraphie.
Me voici en compagnie de Mme Martine Époque, chorégraphe de la troupe de danse Dame. D'accord, pour revenir à la pièce qu'on a vue ce midi, vous travaillez sur cette pièce-là depuis quand?
Depuis 2 ans, depuis août d'il y a 2 ans. Ça fera 2 ans au mois d'août.
D'accord, et comment avez-vous choisi de travailler, d'interpréter le Sacre du printemps? Qu'est-ce qui vous a amené à faire un tel choix?
C'est une œuvre qui est fascinante. Hein. D'abord, c'est une musique écrite pour la danse et c'est une musique riche. Souvent, on a des musiques écrites pour la danse qui sont un petit peu mièvres ou qui ne sont pas très réussies. Tandis que ça, c'est une musique très puissante et qui se prête très bien à la danse. Maintenant, c'est une musique que je pense, une fois qu'on l'a connue, qu'on n'oublie jamais. Donc, depuis très longtemps, je pensais à faire quelque chose sur le sacre, mais je ne me sentais pas prête. Là, simplement, je me suis sentie prête.
Don't forget that this show we've seen is just one in a series of performances. There's also concerts, exhibitions, and other things like Les Ballets Jazz de Montréal, playing March the 26th at Place des Arts. There's a lot of good ways to relax, and if you have a little bit of time at lunch, you might want to try it. It's fun to get away. There's other ways of relaxing, though. Maybe Ren has a little bit more to tell us on that score. Ren?
Well, Some Kind of Wonderful and Angel Heart, they're two movies that are very different and but both entertaining in their own way. First, Some Kind of Wonderful examines the tender friendship between Keith, an artistic high school student, and his best friend Watts, a little drummer girl who secretly wants to be more than friends. Mm-hmm. It's a charming little John Hughes film, mm-hmm. in the tradition of his earlier films, Pretty in Pink and The Breakfast Club. The protagonist in this case is Keith, played by Eric Stoltz, and the crunch comes when he falls hopelessly in love with everyone's idea of the prom queen, Amanda. Mm-hmm. Keith's pal, Watts, played by Mary Stuart Masterson, discovers that Amanda's status-seeking ex plans to kick Keith's face in, and Amanda's the bait. So Watts chooses to risk the friendship and tell him rather than see him humiliated. I thought the acting was terrific in this movie. Lee Thompson is well cast as Amanda, the object of Keith's desire. Of the three, she has the most experience in film, mm-hmm. and after making her debut in Jaws 3, went on to such successful films as All the Right Moves, Red Dawn, and Back to the Future. You may have seen that one. Eric Stoltz, who was recently introduced playing Rocky Dennis in Mask, has established himself as a versatile young actor, able to switch easily from film to television to stage. Finally, Mary Stuart Masterson, playing Watts, has acted mainly in film and television, most recently in At Close Range and Gardens of Stone for Francis Ford Coppola. This clip we're going to see shows quite well the tension put on Keith and Watts' friendship. Let's see what it's all about.
Sounds good to me.
Do you miss me, Keith? Do you miss not being around me?
This isn't the third grade anymore.
She doesn't love you. It's a joke. It's all a joke.
How do you know?
I'd bet my hands on it.
You don't want to make that bet.
Yeah, I do. I've been thinking a lot lately about you and me. And I came to a conclusion that I didn't want to deal with. But now that we talked, I can't hide it anymore. I think we'd get along much better if we didn't spend so much time together anymore.
Why?
Because I'm driving you crazy, and you're driving me crazy. And I'd rather not see you and have you think good things about me than have you see me and hate me. Because I can't afford to have you hate me, Keith. The only things I care about in this life are me and my drums and you. Adios.
Wait, Watts. Watts!
So this movie basically is a light teen romance with a lot of heart, while the other, Angel Heart, however, entertains with something completely different.
Isn't Angel Heart the movie that received an R rating in the United States?
Yes, you've been hearing...
You didn't want me to mention that.
You've been hearing a great deal of excitement in Quebec lately, generated by the uncut version of Alan Parker's latest film, Angel Heart.
Okay.
I think the rest of North America is missing the point because Angel Heart is good enough to become one of the top films of 87, despite mm-hmm. all the hype about the 10 extra seconds. Mm-hmm. Angel Heart is set in the 50s with macabre chills and thrills involving the occult. Harry Angel, Mickey Rourke, is a down-and-out gumshoe hired by the sinister Louis Cypher, Robert De Niro, to track down a former big band singer named Johnny Favorite, who has dropped out of sight. The search leads Harry Angel on an elusive trail from the heart of New York to the black magic waters of New Orleans. It is his desperate search for truth that threatens to unravel the mystery. Based on William Hertzenberg's novel, Falling Angel, Angel Heart was written and directed and adapted for film by Alan Parker.
Well, I'd like to see a clip of that. Do you have one?
Yes, we have a clip coming up. Would you like to see it now?
Well, let's have a look at that. That was really interesting. Now, Rand, could you tell me a little bit more about it? I don't know if we really got the feel of it in a short clip.
Okay, the performances in Angel Heart create rich characters which you may never forget. Mickey Rourke was most recently seen in 9½ Weeks, Year of the Dragon, and The Pope of Greenwich Village. Mm-hmm. Out of the four actors auditioned for the part, Rourke seemed to Parker to be the most truthful representation. With a special appearance by Robert De Niro, De Niro adds Louis Cypher to his endless list of diverse characters.
Mm, De Niro is really getting very popular these days. He's very, very versatile as an actor.
Yes, he is. His roles range from The Godfather Part II, Raging Bull, to The Taxi Driver. Lisa Bonet of The Crosby Show makes her feature film debut in the challenging role of Epiphany Proudfoot in Angel Heart. That's the one we just saw.
Mm-hmm.
She's well known as Denise Huxtable and has appeared in other television specials. Charlotte Rampling is the superb British actress who plays the enigmatic Margaret Krusmark, Johnny's old flame. In the clip that we just saw, Harry was tracking down Epiphany, Johnny's former mistress.
Mm-hmm.
There is a nice current of attraction between them.
So you'd recommend both these movies, or do you have a preference between one or the other?
Well, I think I have a preference to the more mature Angel Heart.
For the 10 seconds or for without the 10 seconds?
Well, I don't know. I don't know what it's like without it.
Okay. All right. Well, that's something else to watch out for. There's just so many things to watch out for that are going around town. One of those things is Medea from the Gale Players Theater, and that's a tragedy based on the Greek myth you might recall from your high school days. And the play combines traditional and experimental elements of music, dance, and theater. Now, that'll be playing at the Student Union Building on 3480 McTavish, Metro Peel, from March 24th to April 4th. Tickets are on sale at the door, and $6 general and $4 for the students, so that'd be one thing to look out for. And following Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, Wendy Dawson has a play for you at the Chameleon Studio at Loyola Campus. The admission's free. And Much Ado About Nothing is also by Joe Cazalet, another student. The admission is just $2. These will be held at the Clark Theater at Sir George William Campus. As well, the dance department's got a couple of shows, really great ones lined up for you. The performances are open house, so you can just walk in. There's no admission. The dates are the 17th and 18th of April, so you might want to break from the middle of your exams. It'll be at the Loyola campus. Check it out at 848-4740. Another one at the D.B. Clark is from the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd of May. If you can't stress yourself out enough to go after the exams, and that'll be at 5 and 8 p.m. on all 3 days. The admission's free again. Again, the phone number is 848-4740. Now, Ren, you have something for us?
Yes, the Tony-winning musical Cats is coming September 23rd to the Theatre Saint-Denis, so get your tickets now. And another play, Lily of the Mohawks, is directed by Morris Podbury. It's playing at the Sadie Brothman Center. Perhaps you'd like to check it out. It's playing till May 29th.
En français au théâtre, Paul. Paul, c'est l'histoire d'un inconnu qui passe, qui devine nos pensées et qui dévoile nos secrets les plus intimes. C'est une comédie fantastique. C'est un rendez-vous avec l'humour à voir au théâtre de Catsou du 10 mars au 4 avril. Aussi, Look et Lune, dirigé, écrit et interprété par Chatouille au théâtre expérimental des femmes jusqu'au 29 mars.
Okay, well, the last thing that I have here before we keep going on to yours is the Cinema Students Association's presentation of the student movies, the best ones for this year, and that I think I'd personally like to attend, exam or none. That'll be on April the 30th, and from May 1st to 2nd, it'll be at 7:30 p.m. The admission's free. It's given by the alumni audit. It's going to be held, sorry, at the Alumni Auditorium, room H110. And I don't know, I think that's what I have to do. I don't know if I have an exam just like a couple of days before and all that, and there's another concert I want to check out and everything, but I'm going to stick out.
Maybe you want to go to the Battle of the Bands that the Music Club Concordia is presenting. That's on March 28th at 8:30 p.m. on the 7th floor. In the hall building. It's only $350.
Oh, my God. That's
a good deal.
Good exposition. Du 30 mars au 24 mai, au hall d'entrée de la salle Wilfrid Pelletier, une journée dans la vie des Canadiens. C'est une présentation photographique, mille et une facettes de la vie des Canadiens captée par les meilleurs photographes, canadiens et étrangers aussi. Aussi au Café de la Place, un spectacle unique, Rénald Bouchard, mon père et moi. C'est ce spectacle total que Bouchard a créé pour exorciser le suicide de son père. C'est à voir au théâtre du Café de la Place des Arts, le 17 mars jusqu'au 4 avril.
Well, we could go on forever, but we have to say goodbye. There's just so much going on for this summer. You might want to, there's things happening. We'll be seeing you in September. There's things I'm sorry.
I guess we're running over time.
Well, I guess we really are running over time. We haven't been kicked out yet, but I guess there's a first and a last time for everything. Mira, we needed the flowers.
Does this mean goodbye? It's over?
This really means goodbye.
Till
this is
September.
Over, folks. Until September. Watch this clip we've got going for you before the sun races us off the side. It'll be good. Have a great summer, folks. We'll see you in September.
Bye.
From Rendez-vous. Okay.